Blackstone Audio presents. Songs on Bronze by Nigel Spivey. Author's note. Songs on Bronze originated from the desire to fashion a single organic narrative of as much Greek mythology as most people might want or need to know. This means a less than comprehensive work. Not every tale of the ancient Greek repertoire has been included here. Some stories, such as the saga of the Seven Against Thebes, are much abbreviated. I wanted this book to be a fluent read, not an unrelenting inventory of names, places, and atrocious events. To select is an author's privilege, for there is, after all, no Bible of Greek mythology, nor any canonical version of exactly what happened and where. In antiquity, scholars disputed whether Argos or Mycenae had been Agamemnon's home. Likewise, whether it was Theseus or Heracles who killed the Minotaur depended on where in the Mediterranean one heard the story told. As for pursuing any historical reality behind the War of Troy or plotting the precise route taken by the Argonauts, I have gone no further than to weave in some incidental details derived from Bronze Age archaeology. If myths were bound by time and place, then they would not be myths. Nevertheless, I have tried above all to visualize how legends were formed, to convey the marvelous immediacy of these ancient storylines. The examples of classical authors naturally helped, especially those in Homer's mold, always more concerned to relate how something happened than just to tell what happened. Often, too, I drew upon images from the past, painted vases, archaic temple reliefs, and such like. And ultimately, there was also a certain amount of sheer method acting. If anyone did see me on a stretch of Corfu's shore, lunging with a stick spear, muttering to myself, let them know now that this was only the author at work rehearsing the fury of Ajax. At the outset, I intended to write this book for my young children, with due regard for their delicate sensibilities. They, however, grew up more quickly than I wrote. So I accepted the violence and sensuality of the myths and made little effort to cut or purify them. At the same time, of course, I am no more than sympathetic to the pagan world. If my depiction of the Olympian gods lacks true piety, I claim the honorable company of Homer, Ovid, and others. A single image explains the title. Hephaestus, the master craftsman, is crouched over his anvil. Before him is a large circular shield embossed with scenes that strike the eye. He has fashioned many figures upon this shield, mountains, cities, forests, strange animals, and more. But most striking of all, the figures of people caught in all the varied postures of their lives. Embraced or in the throes of war, joining the dance or hard at work, whatever their actions, these figures proudly occupy the shield's concentric rings. Their stories stand out, tapped and battered, so tested and true, stories tempered to resist. The master craftsman holds his work up to the light. He breathes upon the shield, the figures mist, then shine again. The bronze begins to sing. Nigel Spivey, Cambridge, England, 2004. Prelude. Orpheus in Love. Eurydice was a girl born to the company of dryads, the spirits of woodlands and fields. So there was nothing she liked better than to hitch up her skirts and run barefoot through open countryside. And Orpheus, who loved her, was inclined to let her go. He was a poet. Therefore, it delighted him to see her move so free and fast. He doubted he could ever match her easy, flashing strides. Just once he tried, kicked off his sandals, and followed in her trail. Within moments, he was howling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.